I bought a motorcycle. A fast one. Call it a midlife crisis, call it childhood compensation. Either way, I absolutely love that damn thing. And like any bike, it comes with a problem. Accessories are stupidly expensive. $100 for a bent metal plate? $200 for two indicators? No real alternative available for a single seat exhaust hanger? So I thought, why not scan the parts I need and just print better versions myself? Cheaper, custom made, maybe even cooler. Creality sent me their Raptor Pro 3D scanner to try out. Not sponsored, but a great excuse to finally get into 3D scanning, dealing meshes, and to try serious reverse engineering. Let's try and build something that actually works, and maybe save a couple $100 and grams while we're at it. The Raptor Pro costs around $1,800, which is steep for prosumers, but still far from the tens of thousands of dollars high-end professional scanners out there. It supports both near-infrared and laser line scanning, and I wanted to try both to learn the processes. I started with the NIR mode and this fluffy owl. No markers needed, decent results, and tracking was surprisingly okay for a first try. The software isn't hard to use, but I wish there were more best practices for settings. There's a lot you can tweak, but a bit more guidance for beginners on what actually matters would be nice. Switching to laser mode brought more insights. Don't use a reflective scan plate, markers should also be angled, and yeah, black or transparent surface is still a nightmare without scanning spray. That PS5 controller was a good torture test there. Total fail on the transparent buttons, takes a lot of patience on the black surfaces. Doesn't matter in practice, but still need to know. Nope, it won't capture the ultra micro textures on the controller surface, but overall, I was happy with the results and resolution was very good. The best part? I scanned something, and minutes later it was printing. Completely useless prints, but incredibly satisfying. Generating 3D files and directly printing that stuff, this is what hooks me. A quick note on the scanning performance. My old mid-tier AMD PC built in 2019 handled it very well, but in the garage, I don't have a PC, so I tried the wireless scan bridge with my iPhone. Connection was quick and easy, but in comparison to the PC software, the app is limited, and frame rates are tolerable but far from enjoyable. NIR scanning the actual bike? Not practical. As soon as you hit black or shiny surfaces, tracking is gone. So instead of spraying and marking my entire bike or regions of it, I changed strategy. I simply removed the parts I wanted to improve and scanned them properly on the desk with my old PC. The wireless bridge for the Raptor is helpful here as well, no cable to trip over. Let's make better and cheaper parts for that bike. But before we jump into the actual reverse engineering, a quick 30-second message from today's sponsor, PCBWay. Besides making PCBs, PCBWay also has a massive community and even a dedicated store. You can find open source projects, share your own designs, or buy ready-made boards and modules directly from other makers. It's like a global marketplace for hardware tinkerers and engineers, and a great place to discover inspiration or support other creators. Check out the PCBWay store and community and maybe even list your own design. More info and the link for instant access down in the description. There are two parts on my Ninja I wanted to improve, the license plate holder and the exhaust hanger. It's the bracket that holds the muffler and the rear foot peg. The license plate I got was an aftermarket part, and honestly, it places the plate and indicators in a cleaner and sportier position. But it's also just a bent piece of steel for over $100. I'm convinced I can do better and cheaper with 3D printing. The hanger is a bit different. It's a beautiful die-cast aluminum part. I actually love the shape and finish. So my idea was to replicate the design, but turn it into a single seat version, because I don't plan on taking passengers while trying to kill myself on that bike. Let's start with the license plate holder. Many countries have different regulations for license plate and indicator positioning. That's why manufacturers go with this awkward, overbuilt stock holders, just to be safe globally. Here in Germany, things are pretty strict. The license plate must be illuminated, angled correctly, clearly visible from the rear, and the reflector is required. Germany has a certification called Allgemeine Betriebserlaubnis, or ABE for short. That's an official approval certifying that a part is street legal in Germany. For many aftermarket parts like levers, foot pegs, or indicators, an ABE is mandatory, and yes, you'll have to show it to the police if they ask. But not everything needs it. For example, a license plate holder doesn't. As long as it's mounted centered, rigid and stable, no Velcro obviously. The 100 euros bent steel aftermarket holder I bought checks all these boxes, and to be fair, it includes a compliant LED for plate illumination and that legally required reflector. It's absolutely legal to use in Germany. Sure, for a US audience this might seem totally over-engineered, but hey, in Germany we like things over-engineered. Safe, and most importantly, without speed limits on the highway, right? But since I like the positioning of the plate and indicators, I figured, why not just scan it, redesign it, and print it myself? Now that I've tried some scanning, this should be quick and easy, right? Spoiler, it wasn't quick, it wasn't easy, but it was satisfying as hell. Scanning black glossy parts like this one? Painful. I knew that. So I used vanishing scanning spray from the beginning, and the parallel laser mode gave me the best shot for this part. Reliable tracking, solid accuracy and details. The license plate holder is symmetrical and only a few surfaces really matter, where parts attach and where the bolts go. With that in mind, the scanner did a solid job, converting the point cloud into a mesh. Also, easy and fine with the Creality software. But again, what settings should I actually use? You end up guessing and waiting. Trial and error takes time, especially with processing time stacking up on a modest PC like mine. Eventually I got a usable OBG file, a dense mesh with thousands of triangles, not the kind of geometry I usually work with. I do solid, parametric, mechanical design, not raw mesh wrangling. That's where Clough42 saved my day. He made a brilliant video on turning messy scan data into usable CAD geometry. Won't go full tutorial here, but the key tricks like constructing surfaces for positioning, using sections to get the geometry and extract hole positions, these are the game changers. Especially for symmetrical parts like this one. After some cleanup, I had a first prototype ready for printing. It looked ugly, and bright red didn't help, but it's a test fit, and it actually worked. Great stuff! I also tried shifting the indicators further outward, for the looks and for safety. Didn't look great. So instead, I focused on trimming weight and making the design a bit more lightweight, skeletonized, sportive. I ended up printing several iterations on the K2 Plus, which is an amazing PLA prototyping machine, as I showed in my comparison video versus the XL and H2D. The final version? Around 100 grams of ASA, down from 315 grams of bent steel. And I think it looks pretty slick. Still, there's always that voice in the back of my head. Can a 2 bucks printed part really replace a 100 bucks steel one at 250 kilometers per hour with heat, vibration and maybe some abuse? Yeah, I'm not sure either. We'll get to that. But first, the exhaust hanger, the real challenge, because this one needs to look really good and has to handle even more. The original part has just 2 tasks: holding the exhaust and giving your passenger a footrest. But I don't take passengers on this bike, and I really like the original Kawasaki design. Aftermarket options? Sure, they'd work, but most of them look awful to me. I wanted the stock look, just without the pack, tailored to my use case. Let's talk about the requirements. I identified the obvious: static and dynamic forces, impacts, vibration, heat, moisture, UV and chemical resistance. And of course, good looks. It's in full view on the bike. The original part is die-cast aluminium. Maybe I'll try that one day, but for now, FDM printing is the way to go. Fast, flexible, and with modern printers and filaments, we have real engineering-grade options. Though PETG, ABS, ASA, PC, nylon, all not ideal here. Too soft, not heat-resistant enough, or degrade over time. SC Project, the manufacturer of the exhaust, says the exhaust area can hit 250 degrees Celsius. Probably worst case for track use. After that, no more questions answered. Ghosted me. So I'm on my own here. I expect significantly under 200 degrees Celsius in my case for road use. I'll need to validate that at some point, but July in Germany is cold and rainy at the moment, so no reference is possible. So let's focus on PPACF or PPSCF. Both are top tier filaments. PPACF is strong and even prints in passively heated chambers. But PPSCF? Even better for this job. Higher temperature resistance, lower water absorption, chemical and UV resistance, and it's actually cheaper. Perfect fit? Almost. One concern remains: mechanical strength. PPSCF is slightly weaker than PPACF, and still far from aluminum. But remember, I don't carry passengers, and my aftermarket exhaust is lighter. This part is more like structural endurance. Vibration fatigue worries me more than load. The Ninja 636cc inline four screams at high RPM, which is exactly why I bought it, and while engine side vibrations are low, dynamic stress over time? We'll see. I ordered a roll of PPSCF from BambuLab. Not cheap, but hopefully worth it. The scanning and mashing process was similar to the license plate holder, no need to repeat everything at this point, but I had trouble cleaning up the mesh. So I started with just modeling a quick and dirty mechanical version, using the mounting points and connecting them. Ugly, but useful for a test fit which worked nicely on the bike. Then I tried editing the mesh directly, both in Fusion and Mesh Mixer. Didn't like the result. Usable as a fallback maybe, but not great. I wanted a clean, solid model. Fortunately, Fusion can convert meshes, if you reduce triangle count enough. My scan had over a million triangles. I had to bring that down to 60,000 to convert and edit it reliably. From there, basic surfaces, mechanical features, section sketches, the Clough 42 workflow. It worked. Test print in PLA fits perfectly on the Ninja. Time to go full send with PPSCF. Since the model needs a lot of support and the filament is expensive, I tried ABS Plus as zero offset support material. And guess what? It worked really well. No welding, easy separation, clean surfaces. The full print with supports costs around 23 bucks. Both the part and support printed in PPSCF is closer to 29, but saves a bit of time. And the result? Oh yes, that carbon fiber surface finish, that metallic snap when tapped. It feels strong, though I forgot to test shrinkage beforehand, but based on what I've read, it should be minimal. After mounting it to the bike, hell yes, it fits, it looks great, and I made it myself. Scanned, reverse engineered and printed using tools any serious hobbyist could afford. But let's bring this back down to earth for a moment. These parts aren't crash tested, no certifications, no stress simulations, no long-term data. Though, they're based on real components and I redesigned them with care. I used engineering grade materials, tuned the prints for strength and validated the fit step by step. Are they better than the original Kawasaki parts? Not really, those are mass-produced with corporate R&D teams behind them. Are they better than the overpriced, half-baked aftermarket stuff? Maybe. For my case, absolutely. Would you trust 3D printed parts on your bike? Let me know in the comments. I will, at least for now. I'll keep them on the bike and test them over time. And if anything fails, you'll be the first to know on X, Instagram, or whatever. Honestly, this might be the most fun I've had making a video. This project hooked me. Learning 3D scanning from scratch, reverse engineering real-world parts, tailoring them to fit my needs, and printing them on serious hardware that's now actually accessible, that was pure joy. Scanned, modeled, printed, and now out there on the road. All of this done in just a few days. That was awesome. I had a great time. I hope you enjoyed that process as much as I did, and maybe even learned something along the way. If so, leave a like, share this with someone who should see it, and hey, I'm on Patreon, consider supporting me. I'll see you in the next one. Servus and bye bye. Shout out to our gold supporters, Gatsby and Chulo.